Today, I'm talking about cataract surgery recovery, when something just feels off. Most people are told that a little blur, glare, or frustration is just part of the healing. They're told to be patient, to let things settle. But if you're weeks or months out and still struggling to see clearly in real life, that deserves more than give it time. It usually means there is a specific reason. And many of those reasons are fixable when you know what to ask for. Hi, I'm Dr. Ilan Cohen, a board-certified cataract and premium lens surgeon. Over the last 25 years, I performed tens of thousands of cataract and lens procedures. And I've seen the same five problems show up over and over again in patients who are unhappy after otherwise successful surgery. So in this video, I'm not just going to name those five problems. For each one, I'll give you clear, practical steps you can take, the exact kinds of questions you ask your doctor, the tests that are worth discussing, and the realistic options that might actually improve how you see. By the end, you'll have a simple, actionable roadmap you can use in your very next appointment. So let's start with the foundation, because if the basic numbers are off, everything else is built on a weak base. The first big problem is called a refractive surprise. That's a technical term. In plain language, it means the power of the lens inside your eye is not what your eye really needed. Maybe you were told you would see well far away without glasses, but now you still need distance glasses. Or maybe you're too nearsighted or too farsighted, or your astigmatism wasn't fully corrected. Your eye can look perfect on the scan. Your surgery can be described as uneventful, but if the power is wrong, your vision still feels wrong. Why does this happen? Before cataract surgery, we measure the eye very carefully. We measure the curve of the cornea, which is the clear front window of the eye. We measure the length of the eye from the front to the back. We feed those numbers into formulas that calculate the lens power. If those measurements are off, even a little, the math is off. Dry eye can distort the readings. Previous LASIK or PRK can make the calculations trickier. Very long or very short eyes are also more challenging. Sometimes the technology is limited. Sometimes there just wasn't enough time spent reconciling differences between different machines. This is where my philosophy comes in. I call it measure twice, cut once. That means we repeat key measurements. We use more than one device, we double check that the numbers make sense, and we use special formulas for patients who had LASIK or other surgeries in the past. This isn't about blaming any surgeon. Different practices have different levels of focus, time, and tools for this step. But from the patient's perspective, the result is simple. The wrong lens power leads to blurry vision. What can you do if this is your issue? First, the simplest option is updated glasses. For many people, that alone solves the problem. Second, if the cornea is healthy and the prescription is stable, we can sometimes touch up like LASIK or PRK to fine-tune the focus. Third, in select cases, we can exchange the lens itself for a different power. A good question to ask your doctor is this: do you think my main issue is leftover prescription? And if so, what are my options? Glasses, laser enhancement, or a lens exchange procedure? And it's always reasonable to add, if you don't do many enhancements or exchanges, is there someone you trust who does a lot of this? You never want to push a doctor into doing something they're not comfortable with. But you do deserve a clear answer about the numbers. Now, let's say your power is right. Your eye tests 20/20 on the chart, yet your vision still doesn't feel right in daily life. That's when we have to look at the type of lens that you have. Seeing 20/20 on a chart is nice, But you don't live on a chart. You live in the real world. You drive at night, work at the computer, you read, you might do hobbies that demand fine detail. Sometimes the lens type does not match how you actually use your eyes. For example, multifocal or diffractive lenses can give you a range of focus. They can help you see distance and near with less dependence on glasses, but they can also reduce contrast. They can create halos and glare at night. Sometimes the vision feels waxy or filmy, even if the numbers look great. On the other hand, a monofocal lens is clear for distance. That's great for driving and TV, but it can mean a sudden dependence on reading glasses. This can be a shock, especially for lifelong nearsighted patients who loved reading up close before surgery. Why does this happen? Sometimes the lens decision is made with too little conversation. There may not have been enough discussion about your night driving, your work, your hobbies, your tolerance for halos, your willingness to wear glasses for certain tasks. Another problem is shopping for lenses online. People read about a premium lens and decide that it must be the best. Then they push the surgeon toward a specific brand or design. But a lens is a fixed device. Your eye is not fixed. Your anatomy and retina and your camera are unique. My approach is to start with your life, not your lens brochure. We talk about night driving. We talk about screens. We talk about how much you hate or you don't hate glasses. Then I look at the eye itself to see what kind of lenses it can realistically support. What if your lens type is not a good match? Sometimes the brain truly can adapt. If your symptoms are mild and gradually improving, time can help. We also check for dry eye, small residual prescription, or corneal issues that can make any lens feel worse. But if your vision is consistently uncomfortable or disabling, we have to consider that the lens design itself is the problem. In those cases, a lens exchange can be the definitive fix. It's a more advanced surgery, so you want someone who is very comfortable doing exchanges and working with premium lenses. Helpful questions for your surgeons are these. Do you think my symptoms are mainly from the type of lens I have, from my eye surface, or both? And if this lens is the wrong match for me, what are the realistic options? So far, we've talked about the numbers and the lens design, but sometimes the problem is not inside the eye at all. Sometimes the problem is in the front, the window to the eye, the cornea. If your eyes feel gritty, sandy, or tired, pay attention. If your vision seems clear at one moment, then smeared at the next, that's a clue. The front of the eye is called the cornea. It's the clear window like the front glass of a camera. On top of that window is your tear film. It's a thin, smooth layer of tears that let light pass cleanly into the eye. If that tear film is unstable, the image is unstable. Cataract surgery can unmask dry eye that was already there. It can also make existing dry eye worse for a few weeks. This is not just a comfort issue. Dry eye can blur your vision. It can make light scatter. It can make your measurements less reliable. Many patients tell me they were told it was just dry eye, with no real testing, no real treatment plan. They were left to use artificial tears on their own. My view is different. Dry eye deserves real attention, especially before surgery. We look at the tear film. We look at the oil glands in the eyelids. We look at how quickly the tears break up. Then we treat it. That can involve prescription drops, plugs to help keep tears on the eye longer, lid treatments, or warm compress routines. After surgery, we often continue or even intensify that treatment because if the window is rough, even the best lens will not give you a crisp image. If you suspect this is part of your problem, ask your surgeon, could dry eye or the surface issue be contributing to my symptoms? And if so, can we do a full dry eye workup and treatment plan? This can take time. weeks, sometimes even months. But for many people, improving the window improves the entire visual experience. Now, what if your eye surface is healthy, your lens power is good, your lens type is appropriate, you did well at first, and then months later, things start to get cloudy again? That brings us to the secondary cataract. After cataract haze or secondary cataract. Here's a scenario I see often. Someone had cataract surgery. They see great for months or even years. Then slowly things get cloudy again. They feel like the cataract is coming back. The good news is the cataract does not grow back. What's happening is usually something called posterior capsular opacification or PCO. I like to explain it in this way. During the surgery, we remove the cloudy natural lens from inside a thin, clear bag. That bag is called the capsule. We leave the bag in place and put the new artificial lens inside it. Think of the lens as a new glass pane and the capsule as the plastic wrapper that holds it. Over time, the back part of that bag can become cloudy. It's like having a screen door behind a clean window. The window is fine, the screen is now hazy. PCO is very common. It's not considered a dangerous complication in the classic sense. It's more like a maintenance issue that shows up for many people. The fix is usually straightforward. We use a special laser in the office. The procedure is called a YAG capsulotomy. It opens a clear window in that cloudy capsule. No incision, no pain for most people. The improvement is almost immediate. If you had a good result at first and then a slow decline in clarity, ask your doctor, could this be capsular haze? And if so, am I a candidate for a YAG laser? Now we've covered the numbers, the lens type, the window, and the capsule. There's one final issue that can ruin satisfaction even when everything else is technically fine. Unrealistic expectations and marketing hype. This last problem doesn't live in the eye, it lives in the expectations. Cataract surgery today is very safe, the technology is excellent, there are advanced lenses that can do remarkable things, but no lens is perfect. Every single option is a trade-off. Some lenses trade a little clarity or night vision for a broader range of focus. Some lenses give sharp distance but need readers for near. If you were led to believe that you would never need glasses again for anything, that sets a very fragile expectation. If you were told a certain lens was the best without a real discussion of your eyes and your lifestyle, it's easy to end up disappointed. My philosophy is that the surgeon's most important role is to be an educator, not a salesperson. You deserve to hear what a lens can and what it cannot do. You also deserve to hear what a backup plan is if you fall into the small group of people who are not happy. If you now feel that something about the process was rushed or oversimplified, your feelings are valid. At that point, a second opinion can be very helpful. Look for someone who does a high volume of cataract and premium lens work. Someone who is comfortable sorting through complex cases. The goal is not to criticize your original surgeon. The goal is to get a clear, honest map of where you are now and what can be improved. Now, let me put this all together into a simple plan. First, check the numbers. Is there leftover prescription? Is the lens power truly where it was intended to be? Second, check the window. Is there dry eye or corneal issues that could be blurring the image? Has a capsule haze formed behind the lens? Third, check the lens choice. Does the lens design match your anatomy and your lifestyle? Are your symptoms the known trade-off of a specific lens type? Finally, check the expectations. Will you promise something that no current lens can truly deliver, or were the trade-offs not fully explained? You're not asking for too much when you want clear, comfortable vision after cataract surgery. You invested your time, your trust, often a significant amount of money. You deserve answers. The good news is that many post-cataract problems are understandable and often fixable when you use a structured approach like the one that I just described in this video. You don't have to bounce from one opinion to another without a plan. If you want to take the next step, the most important decision you can make is who you trust to guide you, not which lens you saw in an ad. That's why I created a separate video called How to Choose the Best Cataract Surgeon. In that video, I go over specific questions to ask, what to look for in experience and technology, and how my measure twice, cut once approach works in real life. If you're wondering what to do next, that video will give you a clear checklist. And I like to hear from you. What have you been told so far about your cataract surgery results? And what tests have actually been done to explain your vision? Share your story. It might help you, and it might help someone else who's asking the same questions you are. Is this normal after cataract surgery?